Good afternoon, dear colleagues. My name is Ellina Minnullina. Professor Emilia Taysina and me are from Kazan State Power Engineering University. Let me present to your attention the report Perlocutionary Act and its effect. The study of the perlocutionary function of the speech act is one of the main tasks of philosophy of language. Major advances in philosophy of the 20th and 21st centuries are associated with philosophy of language. It became either a kind of epistemology or the general theory of knowledge. But any cognition theory has a vast area of significations common with ontology. Recently, the linguistic philosophy that developed in the Anglo-Saxon world and rested upon the ideas of Vlad Wittgenstein has grown to be a particular kind of ontology. In this light, we can treat the displacement of the theory of knowledge by the theory of interpretation. A famous Danish philosopher, Peter Kemp, uttered at the 22nd World Congress of Philosophy, "Philosophizing is never totally neutral. We philosophers have a responsibility to know how we do things with words. The philosophical word was often ignored," he said, "and philosophy was referred to as a sheer description, pure reference, innocent mirror which forgets itself and makes us present to things." This idea of philosophy as a mirror of nature was criticized both from dialectic, hermeneutic, and pragmatic positions. Gadamer, in his work Truth and Method, showed that this was no description without interpretation of the historical situation within which we describe something. And 5 years before, a British philosopher, John Langshaw Austin, had read a course of lectures which contained the theory of speech acts. The lectures were published later as a book called How to Do Things with Words. His theory influenced the philosophy of language of 20th century and became the source of Habermasian universal pragmatics. Austin called any meaningful expression a locutionary act. Language in this role acts logically. It conveys some truth to a communicator. A locutionary act cannot be separated from a locutionary act, which is conventional and implies all socio-cultural determinants. Utterance is always locutionary and illocutionary at the same time. But language has one more role. We have undoubted influence on those who read or listen by choice we make when we say something and abstract from something different. This is a perlocutionary act. It is an unconventional instrument, transforming power of language, making change of person's life. It is interesting that there are special words, verbs, to express the meaning of illocution. To say, "I beg you," means that somebody is begging just in saying three words. But at the same time, we can't find perlocutionary words to affect the person. We can't say, "I am convincing you," to convince someone. We have to find arguments. The locutionary component is not sufficient for comprehension of how speech can be both good and evil. In Austin's philosophy, the question about an external effect of performative utterance, which changes the social reality, has not been sufficiently studied. The key issues of the perlocutive effects analysis are structuring of life world in language, the relation of the self and the other, temporal aspects of speech act, future as responsibility, and the problem of freedom in language. There is a fundamental dependence of locutionary act, actual content of the message, from the illocutionary act with its non-linguistic nature. Universal pragmatics distinguishes the following modes of communication: cognitive, interactional, and expressive. And the following items are thematized accordingly: propositional content, interpersonal attitude, intention of the speaker. The importance of each mode in terms of success of communication is determined by such values as truth, correctness, and sincerity. The normative claim to general validity remains implicit in cognitive speech acts, which explicitly express the claim to the truth. This is the requirement for correctness of expressions, ensuring interaction between people. The expressive mode has its own equivalent of preposition, trueness, and relevance of an interpersonal contact. It is the sincerity the communicants express their intention with. The equivalent of preposition's falsity is insincerity, deceit. Universal pragmatics helps to clarify rational grounds of non-locutionary power, which is analyzed by Austin and Searle, is associated with the speech act, success or failure. Developing this theme, we can rely on the original studies in the field of theory and practice of communication that have become classic. The studies have been made over several decades by Deborah Tannen, an American philosopher known by her studies of communication. She studies acts in terms of message and meta-message. Meta-message, a keyword of the research, is a term introduced by Tannen for a personal dimension of the social-cultural context of information conveyed by a communicator. The texts of neo-Kantian postmodernity have other terms to describe almost the same: tacit knowledge, background knowledge, other terms. Emilia Taysina, for example, uses her own term, cryptocomponent of meaning. But the issue is not so much in the terms as in the variance of meaning carried by the said language units. The idea of existence of semantic shifts in the communication process is truly trivial. There would be no need in theory of understanding. If understanding were smooth and absolute, the main distinction of Deborah Tannen's approach lies in clear awareness of denotation standing behind the meta-message concept. That is, mutual relation between communicators arising on a particular occasion. In the process of conversation, these relations are not specifically declared, neither are they explicitly verbalized, but meta-message is a text, and moreover, it is the text to which authors and recipients most strongly respond, and they listen with deep personal interest to it.